All right, this is week 11, right? So we have week 11, week 12, week 13, 14, and 15. So in other words, we're two-thirds of the way done, and your design is due this week. I will do my best to get things graded and get you feedback quickly on the design. Getting the project done is, you know, one of the big issues. I mean, we'll still have assignments, but that should really be a big part of your focus, is getting the project done, both the design and the final version of it. We'll probably have some time in class that I will designate as a work day, where I would like you to make sure, like, you bring a thumb drive with your project in pretty much all the time, so that we can have a work day, and work day for you to ask questions and also to share with what you're doing with other people in the class, so they see what you're doing and they can learn off of you or get some ideas or provide you feedback. All right, all those things are valuable things. So the project is sort of the overarching thing for the last 3 weeks. Last 5 weeks. All right, I'm getting ahead of myself. I'm getting that spring or summer fever, I guess. There is no final exam in this class. All right, so the project is due during finals week, but we will not meet during finals week. All right, so I should probably put that up there. Project due, project food, project due, but we will not meet. All right, I kind of like to go over what our schedule is going to be. Week 11, we are going to talk about the concept of scripting. And then forms. So I want to talk about what scripting is, because that's important. If you don't really understand the idea of scripting, then you're not going to really understand the forms part of it. There's a piece of that we do in this class, and there's a piece that we don't cover in this class. So I want to make sure that we're sure where we're going with this, all right, so that we can do it. Week 12. We'll probably wrap up forms and talk about tables. This, of course, is approximate. Who knows? Forms is liable to go quickly, and we might be a little ahead of that. Maybe we will only spend minimal time wrapping up forms in week 12. Week 13, we will finish tables, and we might start JavaScript. JavaScript, we do not cover it in detail, but we give an overview of it. I always talk about this class being like a TV show or a movie and setting up for the sequel. You're encouraged to take CISS 232, which is devoted more fully to scripting. All right, but we will introduce it. The last 2 weeks of class, JavaScript, and finishing up the project. So this is pretty much what the schedule is. We'll talk about scripting as an introduction to forms, all right? Because I don't think it's worthwhile to talk about forms without talking about scripting first, so that you understand how forms fit into the picture. Next week, we'll wrap up forms, start tables. Following week, we'll wrap up tables and start JavaScript. Then the last 2 weeks, JavaScript and project. Bring any questions you have about your project to class. If they're general enough, I can address them, and we can use that as like a little mini review or help clarify questions that other people have about their projects. If not, I can tell you that we can talk about it in the lab. All right. Any questions about the schedule? And then we do not meet during finals week. All right. Forms. I want to make sure we understand what I mean about forms. And in doing that, we'll go to a page you probably have all seen, I would hope, Google. All right. So I type something in. All right. This is a form. All right. The text box that I type in and the button that I can click and do a search constitutes a form. All right. A form is the way for a user to enter data onto a web page. Now, what is that data for? That data is to help the website do its job. So in other words, we go to Google, it has no idea what we want to search for, right? We could be searching for anything, all right? So we have to tell it what we want to search for. We tell it what we want to search for by typing in the box and submitting that data to the Google web server. Now, the way this acts, this should give you a clue that something funny is up here, something different than regular HTML. Because all the HTML pages we've covered so far are called static web pages. All right? Go back to your Lab 1, you know, your copy of Lab 1, and open it up in a web browser. It will look identical to the day that you turned it in, unless you've manually gone in and made changes to it. All right? That's what we mean by static. Static means not changing. All right? So, pages developed in HTML are static pages because they don't change unless someone manually goes and changes them. Google's something different than that, right? In other words, with Google, the page changes depending on what someone types in the search box. So if someone searches for HTML, this is a page they get. Someone searches for JavaScript, this is a page that they get. So same website, same page, but it gives you two different results depending on what you type in. Even gets worse than that, or I don't know about worse, but more involved than that. Let's do a search for Italian restaurants. And we'll notice something. What do we notice about the Italian restaurants that it returned? North Ridgeville, Cleveland. All right, there's a New York one. But Elyria, North Ridgeville, Elyria. They're all, like, for the most part, there was one exception, I think. It talked about a restaurant in New York. But for the most part, these are all restaurants that are, like, in the area. Now, one of two things has to be true. Right? We have the world's best Italian restaurants in this area. Well, I mean, there's some great Italian restaurants around here, but that's probably not the case. I would really doubt that we would have better Italian restaurants than, say, New York City or, say, Rome, for example. Those two places probably have better Italian restaurants than we have here. As good as, and as much as I love Sereno's up the road, all right? Probably New York and Rome and Naples have better Italian restaurants. So what's happening here is the results of this page, what it gives me, all right, as results, It gives me customized for my search. All right? And part of that customization comes from what I typed in the form. In other words, it gave me Italian restaurants and not Asian restaurants or not burger places or pizza places or something like that. It gave me Italian restaurants. And secondly, it gave me restaurants close to where I am at right now. So if you have a friend somewhere else that lives somewhere else in the country or even somewhere else in the world, ask them to do a search for Italian restaurants. And their page will give them results about where they live. All right? So, web pages can be customized for the specific query that's happening. All right? That can be done with plain old HTML. Something else is going on. And we'll talk about what's going on in a second. All right? We can see another example of this if you don't want to look at Google by going to Canvas. In other words, I'm going to log in to Canvas. I have two text boxes. Actually, I have a text box and I have a password box, right? What's the difference between the two? Well, the password box doesn't show the characters, so I don't reveal my password to anyone that's they'll be looking over my shoulder or whatever. And I have a button that I click on. I click on this button. It shows me my courses, my messages, and so on. So in other words, if you were to go and log in, if I were to ask one of you to come up and log in, your page wouldn't look the same as mine, even though we're both going to the same page. All right? Why is that? Well, again, the page is customized. How is a page customized? It's customized based on what we type in for a username and a password. And it even goes beyond that, because I'm listed as the instructor for these courses, which means I do things, I have the ability to do things that you do not have the ability to do. I can enter grades, I can make assignments. All right? I doubt even if I allowed you to make assignments that you would add any assignments to it, but you might go and delete some assignments if it's getting towards the end of the semester and it's getting hectic. All right? So we have different permissions. We can do different things on the site. So the site is customized. So I could go, for example, and go into week 11. Click and add a new assignment. And then go and edit it because I forgot to put the details of the assignment in. All right, I can specify how many points it's due, when it's due, all these things down the line. I can also go and delete that assignment. So the point is this site is customized based on who we are. How does it know who we are? Well, through our login. Another example of that, real common example of that, would be Facebook, right? You get information, you get posts from your friends. And when you post it, it goes to your friends. It doesn't go to my friends unless they happen to be the same. All right, so the page is customized based on information you provide in the form. So let me tell you what we're going to talk about and what we're not going to talk about in a nutshell. All right, we are going to talk about the HTML to create the form. All right, so let's go back to Google and let's go to Advanced search, if I can find it. Let's go to Google Translate instead. I can pick the language. language. So I can translate from English to Chinese simplified or Chinese traditional. This is a way that you can check to make sure your tattoo is accurate, all right, if you get a Chinese character, all right, assuming that this is accurate, which again, any software that does translation, depending on what it's translating, it you know, sometimes it translates things awkwardly, all right, but I would think for simple words like this, it's probably pretty right on. Now, notice what we were able to do, all right, we were able to select the language from a list of languages. So I didn't have to know what it's called, all right, or worry about spelling it correctly, all right. I see, or worry about, like, does it have a particular language. For example, you know, for you sci-fi fans, this doesn't have Klingon, so I couldn't type in Klingon and translate from that, unfortunately, all right. But it does allow me to select from a list of things. I then have a button, or actually I don't have a button. As I type it in, it takes what's in this field. This is a little different than a text box, right? This is a text area because there's multiple lines. All right. Let's go from English to French. Hello, how are you? Salut, comment allez-vous? All right. You can even pronounce it by clicking the pronounce button. So, it's able to do that because you can supply your choices to the thing that does the processing, the thing that does the work, and the thing that does the actual translation. And you supply your choices by selecting from a list, by typing in an area, and by pushing buttons in some cases. Those are all forms. All right? We will talk about how to create forms in HTML. All right, that we will do, because that's a part of HTML. What we won't talk about is the coding that's needed to actually go and actually do the customization and do the processing. That is something called server-side scripting, typically. All right, that's sort of the next topic to study in web development after you get some HTML and CSS down. You can study scripting. And there's two kinds of scripting, client and server-side scripting. And what I'd like to do now is give a brief overview of what those two things are and what they mean. I'm going to do that by drawing a diagram that I draw probably, you know, 20 times a semester in most of my other classes but this. In this class, I draw it a couple times. All right, but in my other classes, my classes that deal with scripting, I draw this diagram like constantly because it's very important to understand how this works. All right, we start off with a client, and what do I mean by a client? Who is a client in this situation?
The user.
The user. All right. More specifically, it's the person that is asking for web pages, that is requesting web pages. So it's a person that is connected to the internet. That can request web pages and gets web pages back. Alright? Now this person could be a bunch of things. Could be a person sitting at a computer. Could be a person at a gaming console. Could be someone with a mobile device, with a phone, with a tablet. It could even be another program. All right. For example, when Google goes out and searches the web to build its index, there's a client that goes out and looks for web pages and then indexes those web pages, creates an index so that we can go and search it. But for the most part, we're talking about someone sitting at a computer or a mobile device. All right? They're connected to the internet. All right? By this, it means you can request something from the internet and you can get something back. In specific terms, the specific words that we use is that the client makes requests and gets responses. All right. So, where do they make requests to? You know, to the internet? Well, that's a little vague. All right. The internet is drawn like a cloud, by the way, because no one knows how it works. No, I'm just kidding about that. Someone knows how it works, right? It's drawn as a cloud because we don't care about the details of how your request gets from your computer to the website that you're making the request to, all right? We don't care about it like right now. In other courses, you might care about it. But in this course, we don't really care about that. All we're interested in is if the internet does its magic, all right, and sends your request to a web server. Now, what is a web server? A web server is a computer connected to the internet, so it can get requests and it can respond to requests. All right. Web servers typically have a domain name associated with them. So, for example, Google.com. We can think of as being a web server. It's a website that we can make requests to and get responses to. If we can peek into the cloud for a minute here, actually, all of these websites have a name, typically, a domain name. And they have what's called an IP address. That's going to be like a four sets of three-digit numbers. All right? Where each of the numbers is between 0 and 127. So, I hesitate to write that to make up numbers because I don't want someone at home trying it and God knows where they would end up. But you have a three-digit number, another three-digit number, another three-digit number, and then another three-digit number. And all these numbers are between 0 and 127. Now, why don't we use the IP address? We don't use the IP address because it's confusing, right? Google's IP address might be, number, 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 dot, number, 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 dot, whatever. Alright? Well, that's hard to remember. Alright? Like, you don't know your friends by social security number, right? You know your friends by name. So, you don't know where people live by latitude and longitude. Alright? You know, where do you live? Well, I live 38 north, 57 east and west. It doesn't make sense, right? You give someone an address, a city name, a name, all right? So that is easier for people to understand than the IP, for people to understand and remember than an IP address. So if we peek into this cloud a little bit, there's something called a DNS, or domain name server, which goes and translates the name that you type into the IP address. Because, really, the internet needs that IP address, all right? Just like your GPS needs the latitude and longitude, but the GPS sort of translates the address that you put in to a latitude and longitude, All right, sort of the same thing here. At least I imagine that's how GPS works. So you make a request, you type in a name, you're connected to the internet. Part of that process is the DNS looking and saying, oh, google.com, that has such and such as an IP address. And then it gets routed and eventually ends up at Google. When I say eventually, in other words, it's not a direct connection. There's not a connection between your computer, a direct wire that goes between your number, your machine, and Google, all right? Or your internet service provider in Google, right? It actually makes what are called hops. It might go from this server to this server, and this server to this server, and then finally it makes it to google.com. All right? And google.com can do its thing. All right? What is its thing? Is to take your request and to custom make a page that responds to your request. All right? Now, in the case of static HTML pages, the kind of web pages we've been doing so far, is real easy. All the web server does is it finds your page out there in its storage, takes it, and gives it to you. So it finds, you request a page, and it's a static page. The web server has an easy job because the web page has already been prepared and are sitting there waiting to be delivered. So the server finds the web page that you asked for and sends it to you. So the response is the stuff that we've learned this semester. You get HTML, CSS, and also some JavaScript, which we have not talked about this semester. That would be like going in McDonald's, right? You go to McDonald's, you order a fish sandwich, right? What does the server do? Turns around, finds in the bin of fish sandwiches, picks out the fish sandwich for you, and gives it to you, all right? Now, in other words, the sandwiches are sitting there waiting for someone to come in and order them, right? And the server is simply grabbing them and delivering them. Grabs it out of the bin, gives it to you. All right? Why can they do that? Well, because, you know, sandwiches at McDonald's, there's limited kinds of things that you can get on a sandwich at McDonald's, right? There's burgers, Big Macs, and quarter pounders, and fish sandwiches, and whatever else they have, right? With server-side scripting, it's more complicated. The request is more complicated. You're not just asking for a web page. The request includes other stuff, too. Certainly, a request always is for a specific page that you want. In fact, even if you only type in www.google.com, it finds a default page for that web server. So request includes a page. The request includes all the data that you've entered into the form. All right? So when I go and type in that I want to do a search for HTML, or CSS, or JavaScript, or whatever, that gets sent as part of a request. Think of a request as being like a big envelope that the browser sends a lot of stuff over. So it sends over the web page that you want, it sends over the data from the form, it sends information about your IP address, which the web server can use to figure out your approximate location. All right. Web server can figure out your approximate location based on your request because it gives you your IP address. Your IP address really depends on your internet service provider, so it might be a little off. All right. For example, if we looked up where it thinks we're at now, it would probably say that we're somewhere in Elyria, but it wouldn't tell us that we're at Loring Community College. It would tell us wherever we get our internet through, all right? Okay, so this request envelope gets sent to the server. The server, for dynamic pages, it has a script. server-side script. And what does that script do, and what is a script? A script is a little program. Now, I've heard people talk in lab about, you know, they're taking C#, all right? That's a programming language. HTML is not really a programming language, because you write commands in it, so in some respects it is, but you don't have the sorts of things that you have in C#. You don't have variables and loops and mathematical calculations and can't look up in a database. You can't do all those kinds of things that you can do in a programming language. So you have a little program. And what is a program? It's a set of instructions to do some task. So what tasks do these server-side scripts perform? They take the information that's in the request. Typically, they look stuff up in the database, and their task is to write a web page just for you, believe it or not. So those scripts are sitting there waiting for a request. It takes the information that you've entered in on the form. It takes information about your location and other stuff. For example, a server-side script can tell as part of the request, like what platform you're on. Sometimes, for example, if you go to a page to download some software, the server-side script is smart enough to know if you're on a Mac versus a PC. If you're on a Mac, it will show you the Mac link. If you're on a PC, it will show you the Windows link. All right. So there's a lot of information that comes over in that request. We've only touched on a few of the key things. But the program on the server side takes that information. Typically, it interacts with a database, and the output of that program is a web page. All right? And that web page gets sent back to the client. And what's in that web page? Well, the same thing that's in static web pages: HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So either way, that's what you end up with. HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. That's what browsers understand. That's what a web page is. HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So that's what the server has to give back to the client. All right? It's just a matter of, is that page been completed, sitting out there waiting for you to come in and ask for it, or is the page made on the fly? Now, what fast food restaurant, I said McDonald's kind of like static web pages, right? They have a bin of food waiting for you, and you go in and ask for something, and they simply find it in the bin and give it to you. What fast food restaurant is sort of like server-side scripting?
Subway,
perfect. Do they have bins at Subway that have every combination that you could order? So they have a turkey club. Well, not just a turkey club. They have a bin with turkey club on white bread. White bread toasted, white bread not toasted. Toasted with provolone, toasted with Swiss, toasted with pepper jack. Toasted with Swiss with tomatoes and onions. Toasted with Swiss with spinach and olive. You see, it gets ridiculous to think of all the combinations that you could order at Subway's. There's literally millions of combinations that you could ask for at Subway, right? And it wouldn't make sense to have those out there, all right, waiting, because someone might not come in and order, you know, a ham with ketchup, and I'm trying to think of a gross sandwich. Ham with ketchup sounds gross, right? Person probably wouldn't order that. Alright? So what do? They make it on the fly. Just like Google. How many different search queries do you think Google gets over a day? Oh, you know, literally millions. And what are they? Who knows? There used to be a way that you could see like the 200 most recent queries that Google got. Probably still is out there, I just don't remember where it is. But there's no rhyme or reason to it. People go search for what they're interested in that particular day. So it wouldn't make sense, and it wouldn't be possible or practical for Google to have a search result page for all of those requests sitting out there and waiting, right? That doesn't make any sense, nor does having a Subway having all those sandwiches sitting out there waiting. So what do they do? Well, takes your information, just like the sandwich engineer does at Subway, and do you want white bread? Do you want it toasted? What kind of sandwich? Do you want cheese on that? What kind of toppings do you want? What kind of dressing? Takes all that information from you, the user, and creates a sandwich just for you. Now, here's the key thing. Whether you go to Subway or you go to McDonald's, what do you, the client, get delivered? You get delivered a sandwich, right? What do you get delivered regardless if you ask for a dynamic or static page? You get a web page, and that contains HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. If we can extend the analogy, the food analogy, a little bit further, these server-side scripts are like a recipe, all right? They're a recipe to create a sandwich. They're not a sandwich. You can't eat a recipe, right? If you were to go and order something and they gave you a sheet of paper with the recipe how to make a turkey club sandwich, that wouldn't do you any good. They'd have to give you a sandwich. But what can you do with a recipe? A server, in the case of a sandwich shop, a human server, in the case of a website, a computer server, can take that recipe, take the user's customizations, and create a web page just for that user. All right? So, in this class, we are not going to study the server-side scripting part. We will, however, study the form part. All right? So, for your assignment, I've provided you with the name of the server-side script to run, all right? And you'll simply use that in the place where you have to put in the name of the server-side script. And in all my examples, I'm going to use a server-side script that's out there and is available for me to use. All right, there's one last thing in the equation we haven't talked about, JavaScript. And I think I'll save that for when we talk about JavaScript, because we do give an overview of JavaScript in this course. So JavaScript serves a different role than server-side scripting. But we'll leave that for now. We'll come back to it. All right, so on to forms. What I'd like to do is do a very basic form. And we have to borrow a server-side script. I'm going to borrow a server-side script from Bing, the Microsoft search engine. I mean, it's okay to do this. It's not as though, you know, I'm sneaking in Bill Gates' house and stealing his server-side scripts. I mean, they write it this way for you to do the very thing that I'm about to do. All right, so don't think that there's anything shady with this. So, if I go to Bing and do a search, I search for HTML. This is a page that it goes to. Now let's go and look at that a little closer. And there's really only part of it I'm interested in. This first part is a domain. That's the name of the site that I'm going to. Alright? That gets translated to an IP address and so on. This, believe it or not, corresponds to the page that I'm accessing. Alright? It might not be actually the page name, but it corresponds. It tells the server what page to go. Everything else, and I'm really only interested, I'm not interested in all of this. I'm only interested in, for now, I'm only interested in this much of it. We can use this server-side script if we only get this part of it right. Search, question mark, Q equals HTML. So what do you think Q equals HTML means? In just in regular conversational terms. What is HTML?
Code.
Pardon me?
What the website's made of.
It is what the website's made of, but what does HTML mean in this case?
Is it the search query?
It's the search query. So for example, let's go and do a search query for something else. And I'm going to copy just the first part of it. So this was the search query if I searched for HTML. This is a search query if I search for CSS. Any guesses what it will look like if I search for JavaScript?
Q equals JavaScript.
Q equals JavaScript, exactly. And sure enough, that's what we get. So let's just file this away for now. Let's just file this away in the back of our head. And I'm going to write my own page that calls this script. And it will allow me to do searches for anything I want to. So let's go in and let's create a web page. And this is going to be a very basic form. It's only going to have two things on it. All right? It's going to have a text box and a button. The text box is going to be where I'm going to type in what I'm searching for. The button is going to be the thing I'm going to click on to send my information to the server. So think of the form as being a letter that we're sending to the server that contains a lot of information. The stuff that we put in the form, plus some stuff that goes automatically. That's my request. And it's in a letter that goes to the server, including the form elements. The submit button is the thing that says go and mail it to the server. Now, one thing I'm going to do in this case is I'm going to take a couple of shortcuts just because I want to get this done in the 6 minutes that we have left in class. So this by no means is a complete example. So I'm going to say this is my first draft at the form example, just to let you know it's incomplete. We have is a form tag. The form tag has two attributes. What are attributes, remember? Attributes are additional information about tags. Like when we have a link. Alright, we have a link. Well, a link to what? Well, we have an attribute that says a link to what. Here we have a letter that we're going to send. Who are we sending it to? Well, we send it to a server-side script. So the name of the server-side script is one of the attributes. And that attribute is called the action attribute. And what is it going to be? It's going to be this part of the page that we're accessing. So action equals, in this case, bing.com/search. There's another thing called method. And we'll talk about this more later, but for now we're going to use a method of get. The method of get is going to send the data to the server as part of the query string. So I have my end form tag. put my two things in here. For a text box, I say input type equals text. Name equals Q. All right, so where do you suppose I got the name Q from? Did I just dream that up? Nope. Q is the name that the server-side script is expecting. Now, in this case, I can look at the URL and I can tell what the name the server-side script is expecting my search term to be contained in. If you're the one that's writing the server-side code as well, which is often going to be the case, you'll know because you've written that part of the code as well. So either you know it because you've written it, or you know it because someone told you it, or you figured it out. All right, so that's the text box. And finally, we have the submit button. It's also input, the type equals submit, and the value equals search. Let's make the value equal go. That's simply going to be what's the text that's displayed on the button. So I'm going to go and save this on my desktop, and I'll call it form. .html. Now, let's go and run this. I want to open it in Chrome. There's the text box. Alright, there's the button. And watch what happens when I type something in here. Type in HTML. Click the Go button, it goes to Bing server and does a query for HTML. What's the URL? Well, it matches the URL when I used Bing's form, right? How did it match the URL? Because, what's the key to making this work? Because the action equaled the first part of the URL, that is the URL before the question mark. The question mark indicates data that I'm sending. And the second reason that this works is because I called the text box Q. Because that's what the Bing search engine was expecting the query, the search term, the query term to be included in. So by matching these correctly then my form is talking to that server-side script. So the server-side script is able to pull the data out of my request and go and do its thing, just like it was able to do it when I was on Bing's own page. All right. So really, I just made a different way to send a request to the Bing search engine instead of the way that they've provided. All right. So, questions about this? Key things to remember about this portion of it. The form goes around everything that we're sending to the server. So if we were sending a bunch of stuff to the server, like our user ID and password, it would go around both of those things. If we had a big giant form that contained our name, address, city, state, zip, phone number, email address, date of birth, and so on, then all of those things would be in the one form tag. Think of the form tag as being an envelope that goes around everything that we're sending to the server. The action of the form is the name of the server-side script that you're going to be calling. The method for now, we're going to always use get. We'll talk about the other method later on, but for now, just always make it get. And finally, we have two different input things, a text box and a button. How do you make a text box? Type equals text. How do you make a submit button? Type equals submit. The value of the submit button is what's going to be put on the button. the text on the button. The name of the text box is the name that that value of that field is going to have in the query string. And it needs to match up to what the server is expecting. So this and this need to match up with what the server is expecting. Yes?
Do you need to cite Bing if you put a search box like that in your website?
I wouldn't think so, because it's obvious once I click submit that I am on Bing's site. Yeah. So
they probably would encourage or like.
Yeah, they probably would. You could say, you know, what I would do is I would just put a note on here, you know. However you want to do it. Web search through Bing. And you know, search engines do this. I think LC's search, if you do a search, is actually calling a Google search. And it simply is formatted a little bit differently so it looks like it's on our page. Alright, so it's a little more extensive than this, but the basic idea is the same. Alright, so search engines encourage you to do this. So it's not like using it in the same way that you'd use a photograph or whatever. It's more like just having a link to it. Alright? Other questions? Alright, what we'll do next time is we'll expand upon this. Alright, we'll see you in lab. I'm gonna go and unlock the lab, then I'm going to come back here to get my files and post them to Canvas.
Seven thirty.